Nothing quite like the feel, something new. All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. This is Rob here at Smirking Gun Reviews. And didn't mean to take so long of a break before doing another episode of Bly Manor. I was hoping I'd actually almost be done by now, but, you know, life. So we're on episode 7. It's called The Two Faces Part 2. So this is that big second part of Peter and Rebecca's story. And boy, was this one... You know, we just did our 30 Days of Night review last night, and I remember yelling at the TV a lot during that movie. Just watching people make mistakes, you know, the script writing people to just be stupid. Like, is want to happen in horror movies. But this one I was talking to the TV too. I was talking to the TV too because it just... Everybody dancing to Peter Quint's tune. And as an audience member, you know, we can see through it, but they can't. And the people that he chooses to manipulate, you know, it's hard to watch. For me, it's hard to watch him just, you know, fooling the woman that, you know, is in love with him and can't see that he's a monster. And the children who, they're kids. They like, Miles looked up to Peter. Flora, like, you know, loved Rebecca. And they all just want to be, you know, they hear these pretty words, right? And they're just easily manipulated, too. And so it's a hard episode. It was a hard episode for me to get through because I really was just like, how long is this going to go on? How long is this episode going? And it doesn't end well either. It's a fantastic episode. Don't get me wrong. It's just, it's an emotional ride that just, it's not pleasant. It takes you down some really dark roads. And you're by the time it's over, you feel like you're drowning yourself. No pun intended, as far as Miss Jessel goes. And so it's kind of hard to see at the end of this what kind of ending we're going to have. Because they also, like, bring up a few other things that are going to be important going forward. I know they're building towards something else. Like I said, this show is building each episode to this big, like, reveal towards what's really going on at Bly Manor, right? But, like, and again, this is where I myself have to go. This is not Hill House, all right? Because at least at the end of Hill House, right? Spoilers for that. There is kind of a more hopeful ending. This one doesn't feel like we're headed towards that at all. This one feels like we're headed towards, like, because remember at the beginning of this, you know, it's a story being told by Carla Gugino. And it don't seem like, and it seems like whatever she, however she got this story, right? She's a part of it. Is she Flora? Maybe a little too old to be Flora. Maybe she's Danny. I don't know. I hope she's Danny, to be honest with you. Except their faces they don't match at all. Carla's kind of got a more round head, I feel like, and Danny's got, Victoria's got more of a longer head. But whatever's going on, or wherever we're headed, I just don't feel like it's a very good place. But this is still pretty good, because it explains, you know, more about Peter, even though, fuck him. Fuck Peter Quint. Okay, and his manipulation of everyone around him, and even Hannah, you know, like, it's a great speech he gives. It's like, it felt very Tarantino for some reason. I think it's the pop culture reference. But we start this episode, right, with Danny waking up. And that's all she gets to do this whole episode is mumble through a rag and be completely terrified. Completely terrified and absolutely overwhelmed. Like, she's about to just, her head's going to explode. And that was another thing, was, or just like, this, she's literally seeing the supernatural. She is a grown woman, and she's not like a kid who's sees some of this stuff and is like, I don't know, thinks it's like a game. She, this whole time, I just kept waiting for somebody to bash her over the head. But they've been, you know, like, it's, we know, they've been walking around controlling the children who are, you know, confused and going along with their way, Peter's way. I mean, Rebecca's standing there, you know, and making it sound like, you know, Peter likes to make things sound like it's a group effort when it's just a single idea, a single manipulation by him. And again, it just shows, like, even in death, this character is so selfish and such a coward. And he, you know, he was brought low by the events of his own life that now he takes it out on everyone else. He didn't get the things that he wanted in life. He was treated poorly by the people that should have cared about him. And now he just creates, you know, he's the puppet master of everything. And he'll do whatever it takes and say whatever it takes to get what he wants. And through this, Rebecca and Peter keep slipping back into their own memories. And Peter keeps slipping into this moment where his mother comes to see him and shakes him down like a con. We get to know that some real bad stuff, sounds like molestation here, and other forms of abuse happened to Peter from his dad, and now his mother is coming to shake him down for money by, you know, through the influence of the father. This is what happened in the past, and was this what got Peter to start stealing from Henry? Was this blackmail? Whatever Peter had done in the past sounds like it's not too good, but his shame, his guilt from that is he's being manipulated so that if he would lose everything, basically they would go to Henry and tell him about everything. And I do agree with, like, what Peter's saying is, you killed me in this moment. You killed your own son. You know, first you were just the my mother who, when I was a kid, I didn't know how much you knew and how much complicit you are. And then she, you know, gets manipulated by the father to do what he is to his son. And he is doing the exact same thing. He is repeating what happened to him and made it turn him into a monster as well. And while it's sad and tragic, at some point in your life, you have to, you know, own up to your own choices that you've made. It's up to you to rise above your past. I think a lot of us understand that, or need to understand that. I know I did. I was blaming people in my life for a lot of things that happened to me in my childhood. And how I was raised, and up till, like, into my 20s, I was things were happening to me that I let take me down a really bad path, and it took me a really long time to finally realize that this is my life, and I can't let what happened to me turn me into what they are. And I've been trying to make my own changes, but these people are stuck, and they're in this web now that Peter has created. And for some of them, it's too late. Because it's the things we do for love, right? Even after death. Even though Jamie tries to tell Rebecca to go after what she wanted in life before Peter Quint, to go back, get back on the barrister track. But once he shows himself to her, and shows her, you know, like, what happened, you know, like, not what happened, like, that he's a ghost, that he's dead, that I've never left you and all this. And, you know, everybody trying to help her along, trying to help her get over it, but this is another one of those tragic things that happens so often in life, is when you really give yourself over to someone. Give all of yourself. When you feel those emotions so strongly for someone, for some people, they drift in and out of love like it's nothing. But for other people, when they finally find love or those feelings, you can't just pull out of it. It's when you, like, or when you lose someone to death and you've been in love with someone, or you just lose them, you break up, whatever. It isn't just like what Hannah says, just a matter of time. Like, oh, like, take the relationship and half it. Love and other feelings can be like an addiction of their own. And it's up to, you have to be like when you're trying to quit something, it's, you have to get there yourself. How long that takes is, bit, you know, that's literally a person-to-person basis. For what some people might be able to do easy, it might take somebody years. Or some things that in your life that you might find easy to quit, other things you might not find so easy to quit. Like, when I quit smoking, I just quit. When I finally realized I needed to, I quit. And I just walked away from it. But then there's other things in my life that I can't. Like personal relationships and things like that. I myself feel myself stuck with feelings towards a person that I don't, you know, is gone from my life now, and I have not yet moved on from that. So it's like, what's, you know, what will help me get over that, like the way I got over smoking? I don't know. And that's what's fucked. But they still have this plan to go, you know, like, she's like, we can still go to America, but since he can't leave Bly, that's not going to work. I even try possession, and I thought that was interesting. I actually thought that was interesting. I was like, well, maybe if he goes into her, they could leave. But if they could, they would have. And we wouldn't be having this story right now. But he still can't get out of the property. But it was a temporary possession. And I kept thinking to myself, because you could see where he's going. He's trying things. He says, you know, he's been out exploring and looking and talking to the others, which is another thing, all the ghosts in the house, right? How many people have died here over the years, and what has become of them, and why, you know, he's working it. He's conning it, almost, in a way, trying to figure out how to work this place to his advantage. Because, like, when he eventually gets to, like, tell her, like, this is the only way, like, he spins her a little yarn, you know. But who would tell the person that they love to die for their own happiness by convincing them that it's for both of us, but not telling them the whole story? And again, just everything out of this guy's mouth is a lie over a lie over a lie over a lie. He's just burying lies and keeps saying, I promise, I promise, I promise, I promise. And this guy's been saying this when they were alive, and she keeps fooling it then, and she keeps falling for it now. She has every opportunity to walk away from this person, and she just keeps going back. Like I said, an addiction. I have a person in my life, I'm not going to say who, that just keeps going back to the same person, knowing it's like fucking quicksand. And every opportunity, it seems like they have a chance to get out, and they look like they're getting out. They still somehow get sucked back in by this fucking vampire of souls, almost, like of possession. Again, going back to love and possession. These people who don't know how to take care of themselves and keep, you know, manipulating other people to do it for them. But him, it's to become one, literally, to just take over her body completely. And she buys into it, that this is going to be us. We're going to be able to share this body and continue on. But he, it's another lie. Immediately, she finds herself tucked away in a memory, and she realizes immediately, he's screwed her. He is this is not what he promised her. And again, it's like, it's frustrating to watch people just keep, you want to believe, people want to believe in other people. People want to believe in the ones that they love, and even in the ones that they keep getting disappointed by. And this is the final disappointment. He takes her over so he can walk her right into the lake and drown her. And even then, he can't stick around to watch it. He leaves her body to let her drown and experience death alone. And when she tries to save herself, it's too late. She drowns anyway. And I mean, it's, I love all these metaphors of that are in this. Like, literally, she's drowning. And you know, like, in the way they show it, like in the memories as well, you know, telling her that we're gonna be equals, and it's like, good Lord, it is like watching these relationships that I see play out in real life, where you're just like, you can tell them as much as you want the right thing. But until someone is really, really ready to hear it, they have to feel it themselves. They have to, but, ugh. Floro, though, she witnesses the death. Well, she finds the corpse of Miss Jessel in the lake as Miss Jessel's ghost is across the lake crying and crying because she realizes she's been manipulated into dying. And now she's his forever. To me. And then we cut back to now, where they, you know, they keep kind of slipping in and out. Him going in through his loop of seeing his mother, and them talking about the forever house with the kids, you know, manipulating them, saying they're gonna, you know, him, she's complicit, he's the one telling the stories. That, you know, oh, you're going to see your mom and dad and everything. And it's like, they don't understand the rules. Your mom and dad, if they're ghosts, they're out there somewhere wherever they died. They can't be come back here. And telling children that it'd just be better off to be tucked away in some memory, some good memories, instead of living like this. Just, like, his desperation to get a second chance, and no matter what, to take these children's lives so that he can have something again. And it's just always me, 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 me. And all the ways that he's delusional into to thinking that it's justified. He's a great villain. I fucking hate him. I hate him like I hate, like, Cersei Lannister. And that means you're a good villain. It means you're doing a good job as an actor. Because I fucking hate this guy so much. But I was thinking, it's up to Rebecca to save them, and she's just standing there like a fucking deaf mute. Again, like that person that's been, you know, in a relationship who just is you know, like, I don't know what the expression is, but just like, just seen so much, she's just a meek, timid person, and she's the weak person in the relationship. She just lets this person do whatever. When you want her to grow a fucking pear, right? Even though, we need to get to that. Because I even wrote down, it's making me angry watching people continually be fooled by this monster. They take the kids, right? He goes into Miles, she goes into Flora. Miles goes to handle Hannah, which is where we get the Wile E. Coyote speech, that Wile E. Coyote is fine when he runs off a cliff until he looks down, and that's you, Hannah. The thing is, the way he's talking to her the whole time and leading her out into the woods again. Hannah may be dead, but she doesn't know she's dead. Just like, you know, I like that whole thing. Like, she literally needs to see it to believe it, and then she'd snap out of it. But she just going out there in the middle of the night with a kid, instead of saying, you know what, I'm the grown-up, why are we doing this? It's the story here that led this, and it does take us to where we need to go. I just didn't like it again. Just more manipulation, where she sees her body. She knows she's dead. I still feel like Hannah is going to be the linchpin in this. Because even though, like, oh, and he says, put you in your place. We find out that Rebecca fooled Peter. So she did, in the end, realize this is not right. Peter's lies, he is lying to everyone, but Miles is too far gone, apparently. She says Miles is gone. I don't quite believe that either. I think he's in there just deep, like you said, kind of like Hulk and Banner, if you know what I'm talking about, where they could, you know, they flip-flop, but Banner's never truly gone. Hulk is never truly gone. So she gets Flora to untie Danny, and they, you know, like, we got to get out of here. Get her out. Get her as far away. But then, kids being kids, apparently, Flora freaks out, doesn't want to leave, and starts screaming. And that is when the lady in the lake grabs Danny and starts to drag her away. Now, that is not how I wanted this episode to end. And this is not how I want Danny's character to end, being dragged away to die by the lady in the lake. If that's what happens, I will be very upset. But it's a great way to end an episode. Great way to make people who like to binge watch things not be able to help themselves and watch it immediately. You know, I do binge watch, sort of. You know, I was watching the first season of Evil, and I didn't binge. I'd watch like two or three at a time. And if I wasn't reviewing this, that's how I would have done it. I would have binged this whole thing. I would have just not binged, like I said. I'd probably watch two or three and played some Twitch, things like that, but it's going to be, okay, so today is Tuesday. It's probably going to be Thursday when I do episode 8. By then, it's almost 2 weeks since this show came out. And I can already see by my views that they're going further and further down because so many people just go through this stuff like crazy. And now I've got to hope that the people that watch it a little slowly or the people that are a little slow getting to the show start finding my videos. So if you like this review, please hit the like button, comment, share, subscribe, hit the bell for all notifications. Otherwise, we will be back with episode 8, hopefully on Thursday. Have a great day, everybody. Don't manipulate people. And we'll see you on the next episode.